And I'm blessed to have my dear friend John and his mother and father, my first pastor, here with us today. And it just so happens that I was reminiscing back on my childhood, and I grew up in the Cuba Christian Church, a little country church, and for many years it was just a basement church. And Grandpa Martin would lead the song service. And I was thinking on some of the songs that we sang, and one of them you will recognize for sure when the roll is called up yonder, seldom sung today. The second one I actually wanted to quote the lyrics from is my name written there. And it's actually, I can't find it in our Baptist hymnals. It must not be a Baptist popular song for some reason. But it is a good song written by Mary Kidder, and maybe you will recognize the words. The lyrics, verse 1 says, "Lord, I care not for riches, neither silver nor gold. I would make sure of heaven. I would enter the fold. And the book of thy kingdom with its pages so fair, tell me, Jesus, my Savior, is my name written there?" And the chorus is my name written there on a page white and fair? In the book of thy kingdom is my name written there? Verse 2, "Lord, my sins, they are many, like the sands of the sea. But thy blood, O my Savior, is sufficient for me. For thy promise is written in bright letters that glow. Though your sins be as scarlet, I will make them like snow." Verse 3, "Oh, that beautiful city with its mansions of light, with its glorified beings in pure garments of white, where no evil thing cometh to despoil what is fair, where the angels are watching. Yes, my name's written there." And then the chorus is a chorus of actually affirmation. "Yes, my name's written there on the page white and fair in the book of thy kingdom. Yes, my name is written there." Now, we pick up where we left off in our sermon series entitled Beyond the Grave, where we're discussing the afterlife. And from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verse 27, we read these sobering words regarding heaven. "But nothing unclean will ever enter it," that is the New Jerusalem, "nor anyone who does what is detestable or false, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life." Our main idea this morning is this, that we will all experience the judgment of faith, which will determine our eternal destiny. And just like I read, there is a book, God keeps a record of faith, who believes and who trusts. And we will all stand before him, and that book will be opened. We will experience the judgment of faith, which will determine our eternal destiny. Let's pause and pray that the Lord would bless us as we read and study his word. Heavenly Father, we come and we ask simply that you would enlighten our minds, that you would open our hearts to what this topic means to us, and the scriptures that we read and the points that I bring from them. We just pray that these truths would penetrate our hearts, motivate us to greater service in your kingdom, motivate us to greater faith, and help us to share your love and your gospel with others. Help us to realize the dire condition that sinners are in, that need to hear your word, need to hear your truth, and to be drawn to you. Bless us now. Bless the reading of your word and the exposition of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this is a typical sermon where I read a passage of scripture and then go verse by verse and explore that. This is one of those topical messages. Biblical message, I believe, that will enlighten us about the judgments that follow death. In Hebrews 9:27, it says that it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes the judgment. And from the Bible, we can discern that there is either two judgments a person experiences or two aspects of the same judgment. It depends on the theological background that you bring to the table. For example, those who are dispensationalists tend to believe in multiple judgments. And of course, somebody's right and somebody's wrong, but these aren't things that we fight over. They're just two ways of viewing it. But either way, there is a judgment of faith that determines our eternal destiny, and there is a judgment of works to determine rewards or punishments within that eternal destiny. But we read, and we've just seen from Hebrews 9:27, that everyone who dies, or those who are left alive when the Lord Jesus returns, will experience a judgment. Everyone will experience a judgment, particularly regarding faith. And that's the one we will examine today. Perhaps next week or the week after, we will talk about the judgment of works. But here we're going to examine the judgment regarding our faith. Acts 10:42 is a good passage for us to look at. And it says, "And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he, that is Jesus, is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead." A similar passage in Acts 17:30-31 says, "The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him," obviously Jesus, "from the dead." There's multiple things we could learn from these passages, but I just want to focus on two. And the first one is this, that judgment is scheduled. Judgment is scheduled. That there is a day on God's calendar, a fixed time, much like we would have a calendar and we make an appointment for a doctor, or we could even use the analogy of a court date. And that court date is scheduled, and with each passing second, we are drawing closer to that court date. Now, unlike our human court dates that often get postponed or shifted or just passed from the docket books, depending on what happens legally, the heavenly date is set and it is fixed in time, and it will come to pass on God's schedule. We see judgment is scheduled, a fixed day. We also see that Jesus is the judge. That Jesus is the judge. He is the one, the appointed one by God, to make judgments upon the whole world regarding faith, our eternal destiny. And while it bears no consequence upon our faith, it's interesting to know that even the Muslim faith believes that Jesus will be the judge. Of course, we disagree with them on a whole slew of other matters, but that's one interesting aspect that they believe as well. But more importantly, we see judgment is scheduled and Jesus is the judge. Of course, we see that escape or acquittal from judgment comes through repentance and faith. More on that in a few minutes. But let's bounce back to that idea of those books. Another passage regarding the book of life is Revelation 20:15, where it says that if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. And again, 21:27, John the Apostle says, "Nothing unclean will ever enter heaven, nor anyone who does what is detestable or false, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life." There's actually several other passages, particularly in the book of Revelation, that describe a book or a scroll, and whether that is literally a scroll or a book that God's opened, or is it just metaphorically meaning that God has a record that he keeps of faith, but it is a book, a record that contains the eternal destination of souls. Clearly, if your name is in the book of life, your eternal destiny is the heavenly city, the new Jerusalem, on heaven, on earth. But if your name is not in the book of life, your eternal destination is the lake of fire, which we call hell. Now the question is, how does a person get their name in the book of life? And we must be careful, especially if we're looking at all those judgment passages specifically certain parables regarding judgment. If you look at all of the passages regarding judgment, some refer to good deeds and bad deeds. For example, Matthew 25, 31 and following is a parable where Jesus taught that at the end of the age there will be a separation of souls. Just like a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, there's the righteous and the lawbreakers, those that go to God's right hand and those that will be set aside to the left hand. There are the sons of the kingdom and there are the children of the devil. And in that passage, the main criteria for determining which side of Christ you land, which team you're on, we could say colloquially, appears to be whether or not you participated in works of righteousness, feeding the hungry, visiting the sick and the imprisoned, clothing the naked, social ministry of sorts. And so we have to ask the question, was Jesus really teaching that we're saved by works of righteousness? Well, the answer is no. No, for the scripture also teaches that salvation is by grace through faith and not of works. For example, I could list before you a whole slew of verses, but here are a few. Titus 3:5 says that God saved us not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by his mercy, by the washing and regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit. Of course, we think of Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, where Paul says, "For by grace you have been saved, through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast." You look at some of the teachings of Jesus in John's Gospel, and Jesus specifically addressed this issue of judgment and condemnation in talking to Nicodemus. In John chapter 3, verse 18, he said, "Whoever believes in me is not condemned," there's that judgment language, "is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God." A similar passage in John 5:24, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment," there's that language again, "but has passed from death into life." So that when we come to Romans 8:1, Paul says triumphantly, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." Paul goes on to argue that God has done for us in Jesus what we could not do for ourselves. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fulfilled in us. Romans 8:33 and 34, "Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. It's God who declares who's righteous. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, and indeed," this is interesting, "indeed is interceding for us." Now remember what I said earlier. I said earlier that Jesus is the judge, correct? But here we also see that Jesus is an intercessor. The intercessor. And I don't know much about law and courts. I just know that I want to stay away from there as much as possible. But if your judge is also your defense attorney, that's pretty good news. That's going to turn out well for you. I love that modern hymn that we sometimes sing, "Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, who ever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart." But we have an intercessor, Jesus Christ the righteous, our high priest, who stands before God the Father and intercedes for us. So, salvation, this is kind of to conclude, or another point number three, salvation, and we could use the term acquittal, acquittal is not by works, but by grace through faith. And the biblical authors, depending on which ones you read, use various terms to describe basically these the aspects of salvation, terms like belief, repentance, regeneration, being born again. Justification was one of Paul's favorite words. And then you have baptism mixed in all of that and a slew of other terms. But the idea is that God punished Christ for our sins so that we don't have to be punished eternally. So that if you believe those facts about Jesus, his death, burial, and resurrection, the gospel message, and you have received him personally, like we say, trusted in Jesus or believed in Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins, then you will not be condemned during the judgment of faith. You will be acquitted. In fact, Jesus uses the past tense. The believer has passed from death to life. It's so certain of a promise that Jesus considers it already done. However, we must be careful. We have to be cautious. Because in terms of this topic of judgment, the Bible also warns of false faith. False faith. Matthew 7:21-23, Jesus taught, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day," and that's one of those key phrases Jesus used to talk about judgment, "that day, many will say to me, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, cast out demons in your name, do many mighty works in your name?' And then I," Jesus says, "I declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness." So I like to think of it this way. There are professors of Christian faith, but then there are also possessors of Christian faith. And we need to be careful about that. Jesus is describing here the sobering fact that on that day of judgment, there are those who will come before him, who call him Lord, or at least at the judgment will call him Lord, and say, "We did many mighty things in your name," but they will not experience eternal life. They appear to be very religious people, but appear to also be people perhaps trusting in their own righteousness, their own good works. Hear that sobering phrase of verse 23 again, "I never knew you." And of course, it's paired along with that, the idea of doing, being good, being righteous. And that's difficult for us. These false Christians did not appear to have a saving relationship with Christ. I immediately thought of the Jewish itinerant exorcists in the book of Acts, the sons of Sceva. You may recall their story where these were Jewish priests that went around and they were legitimately casting out demons. And they went to this particularly strong man possessed by demons, and they tried to cast out the demon in Jesus' name because they thought Jesus' name was kind of a formula that you could just use. You say the right words, an incantation, and out comes the demon. And the demon rose up and said, "Jesus I know, and Paul I recognize, but who are you?" And then that man overpowered them and beat them up and drove those away. These are the kinds of people that I fear we will experience condemnation on that day. Maybe you've heard the question asked in terms of evangelism. If you would go before God in judgment and he should ask you, "Why should I let you into heaven?" what would be your answer? And so if that was the question, you know, when we stand before Christ in the judgment of faith, we must not bring before him acts of religiosity, exhibits, you know, exhibit A, worship attendance. "I didn't miss a Sunday. Every Sunday I was there." Well, that's good. But exhibit B, regular and generous giving. "I didn't miss a tithe. I gave exactly 10%, always, all the time." Or exhibit C, you know, "I was a preacher," or "I was a deacon," or "I taught Sunday school for 50 years, so on and so forth. Well, at this judgment, at this time, Jesus will just shake his head and say, that evidence is inadmissible here. It's for another court date. It's valuable. It's information we need for a later date. This is about belief and faith. This is the judgment of faith. And the only defense is this: Jesus died for me. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Or as Mary Kidder wrote, Lord, my sins, they are many like the sands of the sea, but thy blood, O my Savior, is sufficient for me. But what about those works of righteousness? What about the service to the Lord, to the least of these, from that passage in Matthew 25? Well, like I said, we are not saved. We're not acquitted by our works, but by grace through faith. However, works are an indicator of genuine faith. Works of righteousness are tangible evidence that faith is present and genuine. So that James could legitimately say, show me your faith apart from your works, and I'm going to show you my faith by my works. You know, we live in the show me state. That's our state motto. Because Missourians were a little thick-headed. We want proof. We want evidence. And James says, prove it. Show me. He also goes on to say that even the demons believe, but they shudder. So that is the meaning of Jesus when he describes the one who enters heaven as the one who does the will of his Father in heaven. When we feed the poor, when we clothe the naked, when we visit the orphan and the widow, the prisoner, when we do those good things like come and worship the Lord, and when we attend or teach Sunday school, or when we deacon or preach, whatever it is, those are signs that our faith is real and genuine. But God knows the heart. Now I want to conclude by reading one more parable from Matthew chapter 13. And this will give us a good concluding thoughts here. Matthew 13, we'll look at verses 24 through 30, and then look at 36 through 43, and we'll conclude. This is the parable of the weeds, and it is regarding judgment. Matthew 13, 24 says, he put another parable before them, saying, and try to follow the analogy, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared also. And the servants of the master of the house came and said to him, Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have weeds? And he said to them, an enemy has done this. So the servants said to him, then do you want us to go and gather them? But he said, no, lest in gathering the weeds, you root up the wheat along with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at the harvest time, I will tell the reapers, gather the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn. You look down at verse 36, and that is the parable explained. It says, then he left the crowds and went into the house. And his disciples came to him and said, explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field. He answered, the one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man, that is Jesus. The field is the world, and the good seed is the sons of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one, obviously the devil. And the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the close of the age, and the reapers are the angels. And just as the weeds are gathered and burned with fire, so it will be at the close of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers, and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. And I hope you identify the contrast, the wheat and the weeds, the son of the kingdom and the sons of the evil one. Now you know that I'm a fisherman and not a farmer, but the principle endures regardless of the setting. And while I rarely keep nowadays and clean and eat fish I catch. I do take their picture. I'm of the selfie generation, right? So I take, my favorite selfie is the fishing selfie. And I catch a lot of fish. Some are bigger fish, hopefully. And some are smaller. Some are beautiful fish. You see the little pumpkin seed, the little long-eared bluegill? They're like aquatic fish. They're beautiful. They're like those tropical aquatic fish. I guess all fish are aquatic, aren't they? Some are ugly. The freshwater drum and some catfish, they're just ugly fish. Some are easy to catch, so that's no big deal. Some are really hard to catch. But I only keep the ones that make my cut. I only take a selfie with the ones that matter to me. So I have selfie criteria for fish. And that may seem like a ridiculous analogy, but it's true. On the day of judgment, God is going to keep those that fit his criteria. We talk about the love of God being unconditional, and God does have unconditional love, but salvation definitely has conditions, right? I mean, you have to believe. I mean, that's consistent in the Bible. We're not universalists. We don't believe that God is going to drag people into heaven kicking and screaming when they've rejected him their whole lives. So there are conditions. And what are those conditions? What are God's criteria to enter into heaven? Faith. Genuine faith. Those who have believed and received Christ are his children. They are the wheat. They will be gathered into his barn. Those who disbelieve and have not received Christ, they are the weeds and will be thrown into Gehenna, or hell, the lake of fire. So in the judgment of faith, the book of life will be open, and that judgment, in that judgment, there's really only one issue. Is your name written there? On the page, white and fair, in the book of God's kingdom, is your name written there? Let's pause and have a word of prayer.